The interest in alcohol ink continues to explode, with new techniques being developed, new inks appearing on the scene, and new surfaces to create on. In today's video, I'm working with the brand new Grafix Opaque White Plastic. It's an alternate to Yupo that's quite a bit less expensive and offers some interesting advantages. Also, we're kicking off a 30% off 3-day sale on Tim Holtz alcohol ink that begins today and ends on Friday, June 21st, 2019. I'm a big fan of Yupo, but when Grafix introduced the opaque white plastic, I knew I wanted to give it a try, if for no other reason than there's a big difference in the price. It's considerably less expensive. Opaque white plastic is virtually the same weight as the medium 74-pound Yupo, and at the moment it's available in two sizes. So this is the 12x12 pack of 25 that they released, and this is something that they made just for us. It's the same product, but it is so new, it doesn't even have an insert like this one does. It's a 9x12 version with the same 25 sheets. So let's use 9x12 as our comparison. If I look at a pad of Yupo in the 74-pound that has 10 sheets, it costs $20.61 after our 15% off everyday discount is applied. This package of 25 sheets of opaque white plastic, it's $11.04 after the everyday discount. So I wasn't kidding when I said that the price difference is significant. So in addition to that, aside from the cost savings, there are a couple of other major differences between the two that I think are important to talk about. Now, the first person I know who's worked extensively with opaque white plastic is Miriam of Miriam's Nature. So a shout out to her, a big thanks for doing all the initial testing and the discovery. What she found, and what I have proven here and I'm going to show you, is that opaque white plastic isn't stained by the inks. And in fact, you can clean it right back to the white, original white, if you use at least 91% isopropyl alcohol. So let me bring in a couple of samples. Now, I can tell the difference between these two. There is the opaque white plastic is this, and it's just a touch. It's not as optic white as the Yupo is. It looks a little tiny bit gray, but if I took this out and I was only looking at this, then it would look white. You can see that there's virtually no difference in the color of the inks on it, so I have no problem with that. Now, as you know, Yupo has a tendency to stain. You can get most of the color off if you try to wipe it back, but you always can't get it all off. And sometimes if you're working and you've got liquid on there and you put a drop of color on and you move it around, it stains where the drop landed, and then you push it around and that stain doesn't go away, which can be kind of a problem depending on what it is that you're doing. So I have some 91% isopropyl alcohol, and I'm going to put a fair amount on this piece of paper towel. Now, I'm not going to clean all the way back. I just want to show you that you can. So here is the Grafix. Let's slide this out of the way. Here's the Grafix opaque white plastic, and I'm going to not take all of the purple off, but I'm going to certainly take off all of that stream that's on there. Both of these are dark colors, and you can see that it's completely clean. There is nothing left on there. Now, if I try to do the same thing here on the Yupo, I'm going to be left with this big old dot. There's just no way around it. Whatever the difference in the plastic is, it's significant enough that it really allows you, allows you not to be able to clean this all the way back. So here's opaque white plastic, and here is the Yupo, and you can see that I consider this to be a distinct advantage. Now, when it comes to drops, which is all I did here, and let me just grab a drier piece of paper towel to wipe this up. When it comes to drops, which is one of the most simple techniques, and it was the first one that I started with a few years ago when I started to play with this, you probably, if you've watched me or heard other people, you know that it's important that your surface is clean and free of oil if you want drops to bloom really well. So here is a Yupo ATC, and that's a side that should not have been touched. And here is a piece of opaque white plastic. Again, a side that I have avoided as much as possible getting my fingers on. Now, nothing is ever perfect. And as you know, alcohol inks are wildly unpredictable. Some techniques, are going to rely on this, and others it's not going to matter. But even if these were pristine, I can't promise you that the inks are going to behave the same way. They just are not that predictable. I can give you an idea of what I think it's going to do, but at the end of the day, alcohol ink pretty much does what it wants to. So this is Tim's alcohol ink in eggplant, and I'm just going to put a couple of drops there, and I'll put a couple of drops here, and then I'm going to grab stream, and you're going to see me work with these colors again in the next segment because I really like the way that they work. So what you'll notice is that the drops are blooming, pretty well on both of them. I get a little bit of ruffling that's going on here. Again, alcohol ink has a mind of its own. It does what it wants. Now, the one thing that I can tell you, see how this is eggplant, and it forms a pink aura on Yupo. You can see that there is no aura formed here, but when I start to play with this color in the presence of a fair amount of alcohol and maneuver it around, it will break down into the pink. So it behaves that way, much the same way. It's just that you're not going to get it here. And for example, here is Stonewashed, which also blooms with a pink aura. And I'm going to guess, though I haven't actually tried this, I'm going to guess that I'm not going to see it here either. And if I flip this over and put a dot of Stonewashed on here, we'll watch it bloom and the pink aura will come out. And you can see it starting to form there right now. So as I said, none of these are ever going to perform perfect circles every single time, but certainly you can see that the two of them, whether I come back, well, that's a mess. That's not going to work. Now, if I look at this versus this, again, you can see sometimes you get ruffles, sometimes you don't. Sometimes the moon is in Aquarius, sometimes it's not. That's just the nature of these inks. But in terms of working with them in drops, they perform the same. And in terms of cleaning, obviously there's a big advantage to opaque white plastic. This next technique is another where the difference between opaque white plastic and Yupo is going to become very apparent. If you've ever tried to use some sort of a heat source, whether it's a heat gun that you use for embossing or a hairdryer or pick your source, whatever it is, to get your inks drying and moving, you'll know that Yupo is very sensitive to heat and will in fact warp. And once it does, there's no going back to smooth and flat anymore. Opaque white plastic, on the other hand, is more stable when heat is applied. It distorts a little bit. When I use my Ranger heat tool, which I think gets to about 325 degrees Fahrenheit, but what you'll notice, this has been heated and it's come back and it's pretty darn flat. Now what you're going to see me do is take it from wherever I'm working and I'm going to put it someplace on my table, because when I use the heat tool, what's under this is going to get warm and I'm going to want to move this along by putting it on something cool so it cools back down and it flattens. So I'm not sure if you can hear this in the background, but I have my modified old CPAP, not mine, a modified old CPAP machine in the background that I have reverse engineered so it blows out a stream of air that I can actually use to manipulate the inks. That's the noise that you hear in the background. I am going to bring in the heat tool in a minute, but before I do that, let's look at this. So this is two colors of Ranger's alcohol ink. It's Stream and it's Eggplant. And if you look in here, remember I said in the last segment that even though eggplant doesn't bloom with a pink aura, you can see the breakdown of color in here. There's definitely some pink. I mean, there's not a lot of eggplant on here to begin with, so there's not going to be a lot of that happening. Now, the other thing that you'll notice if you look at this is, see this shimmery stuff? I'm bringing in a water-based product. I'm going to use De La Rowney's F&W Pearlescent Inks. That's going to give me a little bit of different color. It's going to give me some definite texture, and it's going to give me some shimmer. The particles that are in this are pretty large, which is why you can't spray with it and why you'll see that there's an eyedropper inside, because it needs to be fairly large. So you'll see me put those in, but first we got to get there. So this particular technique, and let me bring this in, is entirely dependent on the surface of the opaque white plastic being flooded with alcohol. And rather than have that mess kind of go everywhere, what I'm going to do is, this is a palette pad. You can work on anything that protects your surface that will contain that alcohol from going all over the place. Now the other thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to grab a paintbrush. My table is not perfectly level. It tips toward you a little bit. So if I put just the end of this paintbrush under here, it's going to stop the alcohol from running to what essentially is the other side of this piece of opaque white plastic. So rather than mess around, I'm just going to go ahead and pour a bunch on there. And then I'm going to take, this is kind of a funky straw, long coffee straw that I put a bend in. I find it easier, kind of like you'd work with an offset spatula. This works better. So all I'm going to do is just push the alcohol till I can see in the reflection that the entire surface is covered. Now, I also have one of our fine tip applicator bottles. Sorry, my brain stopped working there for a second. This says, I think it's either a 24 or 25 gauge tip, and I'm going to use this. You're going to see me come in and put some alcohol along the edge like this. That's going to flood it back in toward the center, but it's not going to affect what's on there. If I were to drop alcohol on the inks, it's going to make white blobs, which is not what I want. All right, so let's bring in a couple of colors. And all I'm going to do is put a couple of drops in. Now, when you first put alcohol ink in alcohol like this, it's very disappointing. It doesn't bloom. It doesn't do anything but sit there and kind of look unattractive. That's where this or an air source is going to come in. So I'm going to actually use this, and I'm going to blend these colors out. I'm going to mix them up. Now, there's some green on here, which is fine. It is what it is. And I'm going to spread these colors out. Now, I kind of like the way that that looks, so I'm going to leave it alone. And now I'm going to start manipulating the eggplant color. So you can see black right here. If you work with black, excuse me, if you work with eggplant by itself and you continually add inks, if you dry and add alcohol and dry and add alcohol again, you'll see it break down into its component colors. And one of them is in fact black. You'll also see it break out into pink. So I'm going to stretch this up here like this. And you can see that my colors are moving around, but I can see that I'm getting a little bit, looks like I'm starting to dry over here. Again, if I put this on top, it's going to put white dots where I don't want them. So I'm going to come in and flood it along the edge with this thing. All right, let me just wipe my hands. So now that I've got some color on there, what I want to do is bring in some of the F&W ink, and then I'm going to manipulate it too with the straw, and then I'm going to bring in my modified CPAP there, and I'm going to start moving things around before I bring the heat tool in to dry. All right, so coming back to my straw, all I want to do, again, you can see that there are fairly big particles in this. All I want to do is spread this out a little bit, and you know what? I like that. I don't feel like I need to manipulate that anymore. So I can come in and start moving this around with some air, but I think I want some more of the eggplant up here. It looks like it could use a little bit more color. So I'm going to start moving this around. Again, I have plenty of alcohol on here, but if I don't, it's easy enough to come in and flood it from the side. Now this is starting to smooth out. When alcohol blends out, when it starts to dry, which or evaporate really, because again it's a solvent base, you'll see it move and blend and soften. And that's a little bit of what's happening here. So now if I grab my air source, again, this is the hose that goes on a CPAP machine. I've modified the settings so that the air coming out is about as slow as it'll go. And this is an end from a bulb syringe that I stuck on here and just used some electrician's tape to get in there and hold it on. So all I'm going to do is use this, and I want to kind of drive these colors around a little bit. You know what? I think this end is looking a little bit boring, but I have been known to overwork things, so maybe I'll just leave it alone. I was thinking about coming in. So there's a color in the De La Rowney F&W ink. There's a color, you can see the stuff on the bottom, called Moon Violet, that I'm tempted to bring in there, but I think I'm just going to leave alone. And I'm kind of going to drive this color into the center, because that's how it's basically going at this point anyway. And again, you can see the color change happening as this starts to dry. If I want to flood it again so that and you can see what happens there when you put too much in. Once it starts to dry, that's what happens. So I could start to put some color in there if I think it needs another, whoops, as the ink rolls across the table. If I think it needs another drop of alcohol, excuse me, another drop of eggplant, I can do that and continue to manipulate it. But at this point, what I want to show you, what's important is that opaque white plastic is not heat reactive, or it's very minorly heat reactive in a way that will flatten back out. So here comes my heat tool. This is the Ranger heat tool. As I said, it gets up to about 325 degrees. Now this blending is very typical of what happens when alcohol ink starts to dry. It moves and it changes and it's just utterly magical. See the pink that's forming in there? Now there's more of the alcohol up at this end, so it's going to take a little bit longer to get it to dry. But we'll be patient with it. This is part of the process. It's important to see this. And now you can see that those big flakes, those granules of pearlescent stuff that's in the F&W ink are really becoming apparent. Oh, this is so cool. I have no idea what I did to get that, but boy, do I like it. All right, you can see I've got a little bit of a bubble forming here. Doesn't matter. Now, eventually, I'm going to take this off of the palette pad just because it's wet and it's never going to dry in the time that we have allotted here. So let me get rid of this, slide this up there, and then bring the opaque white plastic back into the frame and finish drying this. And you can see it's already started to settle down because it was cold under there. Let me slide this over here. I have no idea what I did there. We cut that off and get rid of it. We don't like the way that that looks. I must have touched my fingers with something. All right, so you can see that this is basically dry now. Let me get rid of this and bring in another piece of paper towel and knock something over because that's the way this stuff goes. All right. So I'm going to put this, I'm just going to move this forward, or let me move it over to the side someplace here where it's cooler. And you can see that this is, again, I've got ink all over my hands. I liked this and I just screwed it up again. But you can see what happens. This is flat now. I mean, it has relaxed. Once the heat source is removed and it starts to cool off, it relaxes back to basically its original shape. And how awesome is that? Think of all the alcohol ink techniques that you love that require a heat source that means you either have to baby the Yupo or whatever it is that you have to do or live with the warping. Now you don't have to because opaque white plastic is much more heat tolerant and much more forgiving. So this is opaque graphics, opaque what, I'm sorry, I cannot talk. This is graphics, opaque white plastic. I consider it about as close to a perfect surface for alcohol inks as there possibly could be until something else comes along. I think it's an awesome product, and I think that it's definitely worth you taking the time to play with.